sent an email a few hours ago about a special tournament being made tonight at 9:30, which is the tournament that Mike and I will play to lower, like, if you knock us out, we will coach you in person for the Thursday night tournaments. And Thursday night there will also be a special tournament starting at 5 o'clock where you start off with a lot of chips and blind people up that high. So that's sort of like the finale tournament. So yeah, so I hope that you can join us for the tournaments tonight and tomorrow night. And I guess tonight you'll find out if you do sufficiently well to be coaching from us in that tournament. And you know, if you don't plan on playing tomorrow night, yeah. No. I don't know how to change that anymore. But yeah, so if you do win the coaching and you can't play tomorrow, then send us an email and we'll give the coaching to the next person. I think I sent all the rules in the email. So how it works is if you knock one of us out, then you get the coaching from us. But if like we knock each other out, then like the coaching passes down to the best, to the highest finishing student, so probably first place. And if like the other of us finishes first place, then second place. And if like one of the person doesn't want the coaching, it'll like pass them to third place. So that's basically how it'll work. Anyways, okay, so Mike, do you want to stand up? So this is my good friend Mike from high school. So I'm really happy that he was able to fly down from Canada to guest lecture. So a bit about him, he turned pro in 2007. So we graduated from high school together, and then during my undergrad, he like taught me a lot of poker while he was playing poker professionally this whole time. And he's, I didn't list anywhere near all his accomplishments in poker, but when he was 18, he won a big tournament in Germany, Dortmund, Germany, for more than $1 million. And currently he's ranked top 10 live tournament players in the world. He's recently done very well in a bunch of tournaments. He won another big tournament like just this September. And he coached the current world champion. So like the guy who won the World Series of Poker main event for nearly $10 million. He was one of Mike's students, so that's kind of cool. So anyways, without further ado, let's give a round of applause.
Thanks both for that introduction. The one thing I need to say, I haven't watched all the slides, so if I'm using any terminology that Will hasn't been using in the class, just someone put up your hand and ask for like what the definition is of a certain word. And also, just see if you have any questions, just put up your hand. This lecture will be mostly on post-flop play. I'll just be going over about 10 hands that illustrate different concepts. And I'll try to be talking about my thought process as much as possible for each of them. These just came from tournaments that I played recently online. Here we have a raise from this player, Fatam 2010. He raised to 12,500, about 2.5 times the big blind. And I re-raised him with pocket nines. In this situation, he was a fairly aggressive player, and I would be prepared to like get my whole stack in pre-flop. Generally, when people don't have that many big blinds, you'll make a smaller re-raise. Like, we'll talk about making a re-raise to be 2.5 or 3 times the size of someone's original raise. Here, it's only about 2.2 times the size of someone's raise, which allows you to manipulate the pot size more post-flop. After he calls, that usually means that I almost always have either the best hand or a similarly strong hand to him. If he basically pre-flopped most of his better hands, he would be willing to make a re-raise. After this flop comes king of spades, the jack of diamonds, and the four of diamonds. That's a fairly mediocre flop for my hand. On most boards that have two or three low cards, my hand would likely be best. On a board that has two high cards, it's fairly likely to hit his hand. But at the same time, if I were to check on a board like this, it shows that I'm likely giving up on the pot. I can have, although pocket nines is very weak on this board, I can have many stronger hands. So throwing a fairly small bet here to represent a stronger hand will like take him off the pot if he had a similar strength hand himself. And on the next couple slides, I'll analyze what types of hands I think he would have pre-flop. So pre-flop, I was estimating if he had a good hand. Like if he had a pocket pair of 10s or higher, he'd almost always go all in. Like 10s or kings, I think he would basically always go all in. A hand like pocket aces, I think he'd sometimes call just since his hand is so strong, he doesn't mind just calling with it. With ace-king, I think he would be willing to go all in all the time. With hands like small, very small pocket pairs, those are hands that usually the board will come with several higher cards, and they'll be kind of uncomfortable. So there's very small pocket pairs, like twos through fives. I mentioned that he would probably fold about half the time and go all in about half the time. With his better hands, there's some hands that I said he would go all in half the time, call half the time, and then other ones that would call half the time, fold half the time. And what that suggests basically is that when he calls here, his range is going to be a lot of pocket pairs that are similar to my hand, like something between pocket sixes and pocket nines, and then also a lot of suited hands where he has two cards 10 or higher, hands like king jack suited, ace 10 suited, hands like that. And now on this board, after breaking it down by the number of combos, we estimate that when he gets to the flop, he has about 8 combos of ace queen, calling half the time, 6 combos of ace jack, since there's a jack out there for some of us, 6 combos of king queen, and I go through and list them all. It's written on the slide here, and then I'll break it down into types of parts of his range on the next slide. So in the end, what I said is that we bet the flop, even though our hand's quite mediocre. And we break his range into a couple parts here. If he has a hand that can beat ace-king, that generally means that he has like a very strong hand. He'd be lucky to get all in on this board. The only hands that he is likely to have that beat ace-king are if he has ace-ace, which he just called it, or if he has king-jack suited. Because if he had something like king-four, jack-four, he probably would have folded. If he had something like pocket-jacks, he would have just gone all in. So there aren't that many hands that are extremely strong. But he has a decent number of hands that are better than pocket nines, where we're in pretty rough shape, like king queen, king ten suited, ace jack, queen jack suited, and jack ten suited make up about, 16.5 of his 43 combos. So about 40% of the time, he'll have something that has us demolished. And then he'll have hands that suck, like pocket sixes or pocket sevens, where he's worse than us, or something like 10-9 suited, where he just has four outs to hit a straight about a quarter of the time. So being able to make a bet to hold out those hands is one of the main incentives. If we were to just check, even though those hands are no good, where he will be able to then take the initiative later on in the hand, which will allow him to win the pot, betting here is one of the only ways of making those hands fold. And then additionally, another about a quarter of his range, 12 out of 43 combos, he'll have ace-queen, ace-ten suited, or queen-ten suited. And against those hands, we average out to winning about 40 to 60% of the time, depending on it. So we're about even with those hands. So having the initiative against them allows us to win the pot more than our share. If we were to just check and let him bet on a later street, we wouldn't have a hand that's good enough to call. So he would then be more likely to win the hand half the time. So what we say here is that since there are those, like, between the 10.5 combos of bad hands and 12 combos of okay hands, that means that even though our hand is pretty weak, about half the time we'll have a good chance of being able to bet. Or a good chance of winning the pot by betting, and we're only risking 20,000 chips to win 70,000, so we're getting a very good price there. Here we bet 20,000 at 67,000 if he calls. So here now we can be fairly certain he doesn't have the very worst hands possible. Like he's likely to have folded his hands like pocket sevens or 10-9. Usually we're going to be beaten here, but sometimes we will have a hand like that ace queen or ace 10 where we can still have the best hand. The turn comes a king, and the king means that all of his hands that are better than us will still be pretty comfortable with their hand. Like if he had a king or a jack, he likely won't want to fold since like any of my bluffs I can still be bluffing with. So this is a hand where I'm likely, like basically the hands that beat me on the flop still beat me, the hands that I beat on the flop I still beat. So this doesn't particularly change much, which means that it's not a great card for me to be bluffing at. After he checks, I check behind. The river comes to six. After he checks here, similar to what I said on the turn, if I bet, he'll probably call me with any jack, and he's probably not going to fold anything decent, or he's not going to call with anything really bad. So checking just allows me to win the pot sometimes, and if I bet, he's just going to call with. He's basically going to play perfectly against my specific hand. So here, there's not really any incentive to bet, so I just check. And here I was fortunate that he had ace queen. Basically, in this specific hand, if I had just checked the flop, he would have won the hand the vast majority of the time. But by betting the flop, it gives me more of ways of doing the plot. This next hand here is largely to talk about the advantage of being in position and the disadvantage of being out of position. Here it folds around to this player on the button, Long Hicks, who he's quite an aggressive player. Like, he can be raising here with most of his hands. He's on the button, and he'll be extremely active. And ace 9 suited, it figures to usually be the best hand here. The one thing that you need to do when deciding which hands you want to raise with the pre-flop and which hands you want to call with the pre-flop is if you're re-raising with a good hand, you usually, against an opponent who could re-bluff you, you usually want to be willing to commit like a larger number of your chips by either, if they were like re-bluffing. What I mean by this is if I were to throw out a re-raise, a player who is capable of re-raising as a bluff, you don't want to waste a good hand by throwing out a re-raise and letting them then bluff you off the pot. So with a hand like ace 9 suited, I wouldn't be that comfortable getting all in when each has 75 times the big one. So I thought it was a better decision to just be calling and playing the hand out that way. So here we just call, and we get to a flop of 9-8-2 with one spade. I check, and then he bets. Now, similar to pre-flop, my hand here is usually best. If he had a pocket pair that was 10s or higher, he'd have a better hand. Or if he had 9-8, he'd have a better hand. But usually what'll happen is I would re-raise here. And again, you know, if he has a bad hand, he'll just hold. If he has a good hand, he'll probably re-raise me. But he could also re-raise me with something that's not so good. Like if he just had, you know, if he had a hand like queen 10 or something like that, where he figures he has overcards and could a queen, a jack, or a 10 to win the pot, he may throw out a re-raise there, which will put me in an uncomfortable situation. Since again, when we still have, you know, 570,000 chips each and there's only 44,000 in the pot, you don't want to be risking all of your chips to try with a hand that's, you know, strong but not extremely strong here. So I elected to just call. The turn is a fairly interesting card. It's the 10 of spades, which basically means before I used to have the highest pair with the highest pair, which meant that there weren't that many hands that had me beat. Now with the 10 out there, any hand that has a 10 in it now has me beat. Queen Jack makes a straight, 7-6 makes a straight, Jack 7 makes a straight, and those are all hands that he could very well have. Additionally, if he does happen to have a better hand, like say he has a hand like 2s, I'm not in nearly as bad of shape as I would have been on the flop, since now I have a flush draw to go with it. And generally, if you hit a flush, when the flush draw comes out on the turn, you have a lot more opportunity to win a lot of money than if there are a lot of chips. And if you were to have a flush draw on the flop, since people, like when you call the flop, people expect you to have a flush draw a decent amount. When it just comes on the turn, they don't expect me to have 2 spades in my hands often. So it gives me a lot. If I do hit a flush, my hand is very disguised. So as I mentioned, this is a situation where even though my hand's quite strong, raising will likely just lead to me getting into a huge pot when he has me destroyed and just him folding when I have him destroyed. So I think it's a better situation to just call. The river is one of the, like, is a pretty mediocre card for me. The river is a king, and here it's very difficult for me to have a king here. If I had king 9, or maybe sometimes king 10 or king jack, I could have played it this way. But he can have a king much more easily, because he could have been bluffing earlier in the hand with a king. And it's much tougher for me to just call just a king. So it's easier, so he knows in this spot that often I'll just have, you know, a pair of 10s at best. Sometimes I'll, like a very small percentage of the time, I'll have something like 2 pairs. But this basically means that in this spot, he can bet anytime he has a king, which he'll have much higher percentage of the time than I will, and he can also bluff a decent amount of the time. The one thing that's fairly relevant here is, say on the turn he had something that was just very crappy. Like say he had 5-4 of diamonds or something that has no way of winning the pot without bluffing. On that specific turn card, he's probably not expecting me to fold very much, so it's not that great of an idea for him to bet with 5-4 of diamonds. If he knew that the river would be the king of diamonds, which obviously no one can do, no one can predict the future, then that would be a good situation for him to bet the turn and then to bet the river as well. But since he can't anticipate the river card would be as good as it was, that means that a bought the hands that would be great for him to bluff on the river, he wouldn't have been bluffing on the turn, which means that there's a lot less potential bluffs than there would be if the turn card had, say, been something that was less scary. So in this specific spot, even though I think if he did have a bluff on the turn, I think he would continue it on the river, I just think he won't have that many bluffs on the turn. So that just means that he can put me in a tough spot since he knows I have a marginal strength hand here most of the time, and he can either value bet with a large number of hands or he can bluff with a large number of hands. So this is a situation where, you know, I was unfortunate to get that king on the river. But it's something that's one of the reasons it's good for him. Like, it's good to be in a position like him since he, you know, by having the initiative, he was able to win the pot against me when I could have very well pulled the best hand here. So I like the fold. I don't know what he had there. Hopefully I beat. This hand here, it's to illustrate a concept called polarization. Polarization in poker, it basically means there are a lot of spots where someone's either very strong or very weak, and if you're in the middle of those, it doesn't matter too much what your specific hand is. This specific hand, it folds around him on the button, and he just throws out the minimum raise to 60,000 when the button's 15,000 to 30,000. Being on the button, he could have a very large number of hands here. And with a hand like Queen-8 offsuit, it's not a particularly great hand, but I'm getting 4.4-1 odds right now, and he can have, you know, many worse hands than this, so I left it to call here. The flop comes 9-8-6 rainbow. This would definitely be an above average flop for my hand, but not a phenomenal flop for my hand. Like he could easily have, you know, a 9. He could have a bigger pocket pair. He could have plenty of better hands, but at the same time, he can also have many worse hands. So this is certainly a board that I'd be like interested in continuing on. We check, and now he checks behind. When he checks behind on this board, usually if he had something fairly good, he would usually be betting. And then if he had something that had no other way of winning the pot, he'd often be betting as well. Oftentimes when he's checking this board, it's something like a middle strength hand. Like it could be something like an ace high or a king high type hand. It could be something like a low pair, like a pair of sixes or something like that, where he doesn't really see any value in trying to bluff us or any value in trying to like get us to call it worse. So when he checks back, it's often something kind of in the middle strength like that. The turn's an ace, and this is like basically one of the worst cards for us. Like after he checks back the flop, I can usually assume if he had had a pair of nines or a bigger pocket pair, he would have been betting. So what that means is that with a pair of eights with a pretty good kicker, I usually have the best hand. But as I mentioned on the flop, when he checks behind, he'll have something like an ace, like an ace high a lot, which means that he'll now often have a pair of aces. Obviously, it's easier. It's a situation where pre-flop, you'd expect me to re-raise a lot of my hands with an ace in them. So what that means, so since he expects me to not have an ace that often, he's likely to bluff if he has something like a king high or a queen high or just a very marginal hand like that. So it's a spot where I think a call is in order here. I think that I'm either have him in very rough shape or he has me in very rough shape, so I call. The river's a 5, and this river is like probably the card that changes the board almost as much as possible. Like basically on the turn, I was more or less thinking, does he have an ace or does he not have an ace? That's the main concern as far as whether I beat or not. The 5 means that now if he just has a pair of aces, it's not that strong of a hand. I could have easily hit two pair of the hand like 8-5 suited or 6-5 suited. I could have hit a straight with a hand like 8-7 or 6-7. The top hands have been completely changed by this 5 on the river. So what that means is that it doesn't make that much sense for someone like him to be betting like a weak ace. Like say something like ace 4. A lot of people will check a hand like this 100% of the time. Since basically, the way that people would typically react in my shoes when faced with a bet like that is to maybe call all hands that are 2 pair or better and to fold all hands that are 1 pair or worse. So say I had a hand like 6-5, you know, most people would call. Say I had a hand like ace 10, most people would fold. I think that's a fairly typical strategy that a lot of people would employ in this situation, especially when this is coupled by him making a relatively large bet. What there's 285,000 in the pot, and he bets 160,000. Oh yeah, by the way, you guys will notice that the bet sizing, like people often type in like weird numbers, like they bet 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I think that's just people playing online poker get kind of bored, myself included. So people like to experiment with funny bet sizing. Certainly doesn't make things easier for the lecture, but yeah, if anyone ever has trouble reading the bet sizing, just put up your hand and let me know, since sometimes it gets hidden behind chip stacks and they're like, the stacks get so large as well. So anyways, when he bets 160,000 to 290,000, I think the worst hands he would be value betting, he might bet smaller than that. Basically what happens here is his range gets very polarized to very good hands and very very bad hands. So like we call here since we don't expect him to be value betting very much. So basically, as I mentioned in, just a minute ago, in poker your range is often partitioned into two parts. Like say you're in a situation where you're pre-flopping and deciding whether to raise the hand or hold the hand. What you do is with your best, you know, 10% of hands, or your best 50% of hands, you'll decide to raise, and then with the worst hands, you'll fold. Or similarly, say I bet and my opponent goes all in, I'll call all in with the best hands and fold the worst hands, and there we're just partitioned into two parts of our range. In a situation where you're deciding whether to bet for value or to bet as a bluff, your range gets partitioned into three parts. What you do is you bet with your best hands, you check with your middle hand, since you don't think there's that much incentive to betting, and then you bluff with your worst hand, and that's what the concept of polarization is. And as I mentioned, a very weak, predictable player may only be bluffing, or may only be betting if they have a 7 here for a straight, and against someone like that, they're extremely polarized. Like basically, if they're only betting a 7 or an unpaired hand, that means that whether I have pocket pair of twos, or whether I have, you know, a set of aces, that means that those hands are basically equivalent. So when you encounter an opponent like that, the situation matters a lot more than your hand, so long as you're in between those two poles of the worst hand that they would value bet and the best hand that they would bluff. So and the final concept that I mentioned at the bottom is generally the bigger that someone bets, the more polarized they are. Like if at the 290,000 pot, if he only bets say 20 or 30% of the pot, like he bets 60,000 or 90,000, I would assume it's likely that then he's value betting with a more marginal hand, like something like ace 10 or ace queen. But when he bets bigger like that, I assume he's either trying to induce me to call to win a big pot, or he's trying to just induce me to fold. So here I thought he was very polarized and decided that even though I only have third pair, it was a good situation to call. As I mentioned, Say you assume that someone is playing that strategy where they're only calling two pair of or better, holding one pair or worse. He should only be betting his medium two pair or better. Like say he has 9-5 for middle pair and or second pair and bottom pair. That should probably be about the worst hand you bet, since that would be about half of my two pair hands. And he should only bluff his below average one pair hands. So he should be bluffing something like 10-6 or worse, which would be fourth pair. So what that means is that whether I have two pair like 8-6 or one pair like Jack-6, they're similarly strong. In the end, I got very owned. He was actually betting like a fairly marginal hand for value, and that's something that happens. Like I chose hands for this PowerPoint that would illustrate interesting concepts, not just the hands where I made the best decisions. As it was, I made a pretty terrible decision, and he was value betting with a hand I thought he wouldn't be capable of value betting. So I made a fairly inaccurate play there, but that's something that happens in this game when it's a game of incomplete information. Sometimes you make a play that you anticipate to be right a large percent of the time, and it just doesn't happen to be right, and that's what happened there. Now we're going to get on to a fairly basic pre-flop hand. Early on in this course, Will was talking about which hands people should be raising from early position, and he mentioned a very tight range. Say pocket pairs eights or higher, ace queen offsuit or better, and then king queen suited and ace jack suited, I believe. And the reason he recommended this range is those are hands that when you play them, they'll usually make fairly good hands and you'll be faced with fairly easy decisions. When you're watching poker on TV and you see someone, you know, raise with 5-2 suited or jack 7 suited or something, what they're doing is they're basically acknowledging that they have a weaker pre-flop holding. And with weaker pre-flop holdings, you're going to make the best hand a lower percentage of the time, and you're going to need to bluff a higher percentage of the time. And since you're bluffing a higher percentage of the time, you need better judgment as to which spots are good to bluff and which spots aren't good to bluff. So what that means is experience is generally, you know, very useful in playing more speculative hands, since you'll need to decide which types of cards you should be bluffing on, which types of cards you shouldn't be bluffing on. And this hand is just a fairly simple example of like what sort of analysis we use as far as when to be bluffing and when not to. So here I raise with Jack 10 suited, which is one of the better speculative hands from early position. And here we basically talk about how to decide like when to bluff, basically. Basically when playing poker, most hands don't get to showdown. So most of the time, your cards don't matter that much. They only matter when you get to showdown and you see what, like you compare what you have to what your opponent has. And then basically you want to be playing hands that by the time they get to showdown are likely to be good hands. So there's some hands that, you know, say a hand like pocket fours pre-flop. Most likely if you have pocket fours pre-flop, you're going to have the best hand. Like most likely someone will have a higher pocket pair. But unless the board has a four on it, you're not going to be that excited. Like they just call you with something very marginal, like, you know, queen seven. If they just had a queen or a seven, they're going to end up with a better hand. So with speculative hands that are somewhat likely to hit straights or flushes and be able to block people off when they don't, that gives you the incentive to win pots without a showdown, but also make very strong like five card hands, like I mentioned, straights or flushes by the time you get to showdown. So this means that like you want to select hands that are likely to improve. So here we have the guy that cut off calls, and all the other players fold. The flop comes ace-8-2 with one spade and two clubs. Generally, when the board comes with an ace on it, especially a board with like an ace and a deuce, it means that there's a large distance between the cards on board, which means, you know, on this board, he can't have a straight draw, so hands like that are just, you know, completely thrown into his range. If he has something like a pocket pair, the pocket pair can easily be in rough shape, like a hand like pocket sixes is not doing that strong here. And on these ace-high boards, the pre-flop aggressor can win the pot quite like a larger percentage of the time than pretty much any other type of board. So typically, by betting out here, you'll win the pot a good percentage of the time. And in the end, he calls. So now we're going to try to look at what types of hands we think he'd call with, and what types of, how many more bets it would take to get those hands to fold. Okay, so when he calls the flop, we need to think of what sort of hands he'd call. So the board is ace of spades, eight of clubs, two of clubs. We think that in this spot, most people, if they have, say, a pocket pair of sevens or lower, would be folding. If they have an eight in their hand, so like a pair of eights, they'd usually be calling. If they have an ace in their hand, they'll always be calling. If they have a big pocket pair of pre-flop, they'll usually be calling as well, but a lot of like a pocket pair of nines or nine or higher. But a lot of those pocket pairs they'd be re-raising. Also, if he has a flush draw, he'd be calling. So the one thing to think about is if someone, say you're trying to think about what types of hands someone would play pre-flop, if someone's only willing to play a suited version of a hand, it's four times as difficult for them to have that hand as it is for them to have, like, to have that hand if they're playing the offsuit version. So as an example, let's say we're comparing the hands ace-jack and 9-8. Likely pre-flop, a good opponent will only be calling if they have 9-8 suited and folding if they have 9-8 offsuit. But they'll be calling whether they have ace-jack offsuit or ace-jack suited. So since there's 16 combinations of ace-jack and only 4 combinations of 9-8 suited, it's 4 times as likely that they could have a hand like ace-jack as it is when they have a hand like 9-8. So that means on a board like this, when there's more offsuit aces they'd be playing than offsuit eights, they're going to have an ace in their hand a lot more than they're going to have an eight. So that means, like, combinatorically, he's going to have top pair here a fairly large percentage of the time. So basically, there's a couple types of hands he could have. If he has a hand like 9-9 or 9-8 suited for some sort of like middle pair like that, if we bet the turn, he's usually going to be folding more or less regardless of what the turn is. If he has a flush draw, what's usually going to happen is if we check the turn, he's usually going to bet the turn and we'll fold. If we bet the turn and check the river, he'll usually be betting the river, so he'll win there as well. So if he has a flush draw, we're usually going to need to bet the turn and bet the river and have him not make his flush. So that's quite a few things that we need to have go right for him to fold against a flush draw. And then if he has an ace, if he has a big ace, he's likely never going to be folding again. If he has a small ace, we're probably going to need to bet the turn and the river. So basically, if we look at the hands he called flop need to apply a fair bit of pressure to get him to pull a large percentage of these hands. So now we want to like look at what types of cards would be good for him. As we mentioned, we have jack tens of spades. There's one spade on the board, an ace, and eight, and two. If we hit a spade, we'll have a flush draw that gives us nine outs to make the best hand, which is fairly substantial. If we hit an eight, we could then hit a queen or a seven on the river to give us a straight that's eight outs. If we hit a queen, we could hit an eight or a king that's also eight outs. I would say all of those cards give you the opportunity that you should be betting. And then other than those cards, the next best cards in order would be a king followed by a seven. A king gives you like four outs to hit a straight. A seven gives you four outs to hit a straight as well, but with a seven, your hand is less threatening if he has a middle pair. Say he had a pair like jacks or queens. If a king comes on the turn, you're able to put a lot more pressure on him than if a seven comes on the turn, since now there are two cards on board that beat him. So I'd say a king would be like behind the cards that give you eight or more outs. King would be the next best card followed by a seven. Here we get a seven, which is kind of, it's sort of like, it's you know probably about a median card as far as how good it is to bet. In the end, I decided this is probably about the best card that we would like to check with. And now he checks behind. When he bets here, he would usually be betting his strong hands, like if he had a big ace, or if he had three of a kind, or if he had something like a weak flush draw, he'd usually be betting those hands. And then he'd be checking with his middle hands, such as like a weak ace, an eight, pocket tens, things like that are in the middle. That's what he's usually checking with. The river comes to four, which is completely non-threatening. And since we know here that he usually has something relatively strong, he's like something like, you know, a pair of tens or a small ace or something, and we haven't been taking that much initiative. By betting, we're not that likely to win the pot, since he's likely to just have some, like it's best to just try to bluff people when you don't think they have that much, and here he probably thinks his hand is best the majority of the time. So we elect to check, and he checks behind with pocket jacks. Here that's like pretty much exactly what one would anticipate you would have in this spot, but at the same time, there's not really much you can do about it. Like sometimes in poker you just, you know, the hand occurs in a way where despite the information you're given, there's not really a good way to win the pot. Now here we come to a fairly interesting hand, which kind of goes back to that topic of polarization. Here we have this pop-up fast player raising to 200 with blinds of 50 and 100. We only have 2,050 chips, which is, we're getting into a fairly short stack territory. If he had raised from a later position, probably from the hijack or later, we would have just gone all in here. As it was, when he raises from early position, he's likely to have a better hand than us. And if we go all in, if he has a bad hand, we'll just pick up the 440 chips that are out there. And if he has something bad, if he has something good, we're going to get all in for like 4,000 chip pot with only about 1 in 3 chance of winning or so, which like averages out to losing substantially more. So we elected to just call. The flop comes ace-7-7 with two hearts. This flop is fairly safe. He probably doesn't have a 7 pre-flop that often, since as I mentioned, like common directly, people will usually only play the suited versions of 7s, and even then, not that high of a percentage of the time. Like even his best 7s, like maybe ace-7 suited and 8-7 suited, he still might be folding those pre-flop. So he won't have a 7 that often. We're mostly beat by hands like, you know, pocket 7s, pocket aces, ace-queen, ace-king, are the main ones we're afraid of. Here, usually he wins either a very high percentage against the hands mentioned, or a very low percentage with hands like, you know, king-queen, or pocket 5s, or something like that. So we like to call here. When we call here, the opponent was probably expecting us to fold the majority of the time when we have something like king-queen or pocket 6s that don't connect with the board. So when we call, the opponent should probably be thinking that we either have an ace or we have two hearts in our hand. He probably anticipates that we have a relatively strong hand most of the time. The turn is the 10 heart. So now here we have top pair and we have a flush draw. And as we mentioned, that he probably expects us on the flop to either have top pair or a flush draw, which would now be a flush. So I check to him, and he bets. When he bets here, he's probably bluffing a very small percentage of the time, since if he can anticipate what types of hands we're likely to have, he should expect us to have something fairly good. So when he bets here, we're getting a fairly good odds. We're getting a 3.5 to 1, but we're usually beat. The thing is, if we're beat by a hand like, you know, ace-queen or ace-10, We can either hit a jack to win, which is three outs. We can hit ace to chop, which is two half outs, so one out. Or we can hit one of nine remaining hearts, which is nine outs. So that totals 13 outs out of like 44 cards that are left in the deck. So we're only about a 2.5 to 1 underdog, getting a price of 3.5 to 1. So we're not in as that bad a shape, especially when he could have some bluffs here. The only bluffs he would have here would be hands where he thinks his hand is a strong enough semi-bluff, he has enough equity, such that he doesn't mind getting it all in against us. And those hands would be something like king-queen with the king of hearts, or king-jack with the king of hearts, or king-queen with the queen of hearts, probably. So in the end, we call. The river's the nine of hearts. And this brings up a fairly interesting discussion. A lot of people, they see that we call this river, or they see that we call this turn, and at this point we're getting a price of 3 to 1, and they assume, like, you know, if you look at the absolute value of our hands, we went from having two pair to having a flush. Like, usually when people improve their hand, that generally means they're faced with a bet when they have a weaker hand. They are a weaker hand, absolutely. Now that they have a stronger hand, they'd still want to call a bet. But when that ends up happening here is there are a lot of spots where your hand improves absolutely, but relative to the hands he could have, it doesn't get that much better. And I'm going to look at the types of hands he could have and try to break it down. So as I mentioned, when he's on the turn, he's likely in the second bluff. He's likely only betting good hands on the turn, so hands like ace king, ace ten, sets, or any flush, as well as a couple of those draws, and then from that range of hands, the only hands that I beat would be ace 10 or ace king and a small flush. If you look at the specific board, when the jack of hearts, the 10 of hearts, the 9 of hearts, and the 7 of hearts are all accounted for him to have a flush that involves smaller hearts than mine, like the biggest flush that involves a lower flush than us would be 8-6 of hearts, but that makes a straight flush, which beats us. And then other than that, you could have hands like 6-5 of hearts, 6-4 of hearts, 5-4 of hearts. But we're really getting down into the territory of a very limited number of flushes that he could have. There just aren't that many smaller flushes that he could possibly have. And also, he would likely check those hands back. As far as his semi-bluffs, those hands like king-jack with the king of hearts, king-queen with the queen of hearts, every single one of those hands is now completed into a better hand. So basically, what this means is, on the turn, we would say he had a relatively polarized range as to hands that beat us and then hands that have okay equity against us. Now on the river, his hand would be polarized to being, you know, very strong hands that beat us. And on the other end of the pole, there's just no weak hands. Like, there's basically nothing he can have. Like, everything he would have would be in that doesn't beat us would be in that middle strength hand, where he'd just want to check it. There's nothing he can really have in this situation where it would be a pure bluff and there'd be an incentive for him to try to bluff us off the pot. So the way that most opponents play here, even though we have a flush and it's, you know, beats a lot of hands, when he bets all three times, we win basically 0% of the time. So even though we're getting like 3-1 odds and only need 25% to win, we're likely just winning the spot 0% of the time. So despite the fact our hand is relatively strong, when there's not that many bluffs you can reasonably have, it's fine to just fold and small like that. So we fold, and it's just a reminder.
Do you call the river if the 7 of spades on the flop is like, say, a 2 of spades instead?
Yeah, if it was a 2 of spades instead, I would say that, let me think. I would probably fold if I got there in that spot. I think that, I don't think it changes the number of hands he can have that much. Like,
yeah,
it doesn't. There's less full houses he could have, but at the same time there's still plenty of flushes that would beat us. So I think in that spot it would basically mean his value range is a little bit smaller, but still when his bluff range is virtually non-existent, that's still, like, it doesn't really matter whether his value range has a million hands in it or one hand in it, if his bluff range is literally non-existent, because in that spot, whether he has, you know, one value hand or a million value hands, it's still 100% value. And if the worst hand can value that is still better than us, it doesn't particularly matter.
Okay, cool. Another thing I forgot to tell you is I usually take around like a 3-minute break around this time, so
right,
this
cool.
is probably a good halfway.
I'll give you guys a couple minute break, and then if anyone has any questions, just feel free to ask, and if not, I'll get back in a couple minutes.